Namaskar, dear learners and listeners. I'm Anita Devraj, and today I am going to discuss a very important topic with you. This is the emergence of Gandhi and the national movement. The post-war years, that is, the First World War years, starting from 1914 to 1918, saw growing unrest in the country as the impact of the war on the economy of India became more apparent. War led to rise in the prices, scarcity, unemployment, which added to the already the post-war years. The First World War, which ended in 1918, saw growing unrest in the country as the impact of the war on the economy of India became more apparent. War led to rise in the prices, scarcity, unemployment, etc., added to which there was an influenza epidemic. Wartime necessities had given rise to a class of entrepreneurs in India, and a large working class was also created that was becoming more organized. This working class was restive and a potential force in the nationalist movement. Part of the capitalist class was loyal to the colonial state because it helped them control the labor force. However, there was also some among them who were supportive of the national movement. They were opposed to the economic policies of the colonial government, and they realized that the end result of British policy would be to the detriment of Indian industry. The arrival of Gandhi in these turbulent times marked yet another phase in the nationalist movement. Gandhi, who arrived in India in 1915, used his own methods to harness these forces that existed in India in the post-war years. His style was to address specific issues and laws and organize a peaceful resistance and violation of the laws with the help of disciplined cadres. The significance of Gandhi's movement was that he brought the focus upon specific issues. He first achieved success in three movements in Champaran Kheda and Ahmedabad respectively. The first two were peasant movements, and the last was a strike of the mill workers of Ahmedabad. The peasantry at Champaran was agitating against the European planters who forced them to cultivate indigo. There was a history of peasant unrest against planters in Champaran. Rajkumar Shukla, one of the peasant leaders, went all the way to Lucknow to invite Gandhi to see their plight. Gandhi instituted an open inquiry into the matter in 1917. The Champaran movement also got wider publicity, with the government trying to restrict Gandhi's entry into that area and later letting him go there on threat of satyagraha. The outcome of the Champaran movement was that the Tin Kathia system, under which the farmers had to cultivate indigo, that in 3/20 of these holdings, was abolished. The next movement Gandhi associated himself with was the agitation of the mill workers at Ahmedabad. The dispute between the workers and the owners had occurred due to the withdrawal of the plague bonus. The owners withdrew the bonus after the epidemic had passed, and the workers opposed the withdrawal because of the rising prices after the war. Gandhi persuaded the workers and owners to negotiate before a tribunal. The owners suddenly withdrew from the arbitration on the pretext of a strike called by some workers and declared that they were ready to give only 20% bonus and threatened dismissal to these workers who did not comply. Gandhi was greatly offended by this breach of agreement and declared that after proper study of the production cost, profits and the cost of living, the conclusion was drawn that the workers were justified in asking for 35% increase in wages. Ambalal Sarabhai, One of the mill owners was a close friend of Gandhi and had given a liberal donation to his ashram at Sabarmati, and his sister Ansuya Ben was one of his greatest supporters in the Ahmedabad mill workers' struggle. During the last stages of the struggle, Gandhi for the first time used the fast as a means of protest. Gandhi observed that the workers were slowly losing their morale, so he decided to go on a fast. He declared that if the strike was to lead to starvation, then he should be the first to do so. And the matter was firmly resolved, with the workers getting 35% raise. Now, the third movement was that of the Kedah peasants whose crops had failed and they were unable to get a remission of land revenue from the government. First, inquiries were made into the situation, as was the norm of all Gandhian movements. Crop yields were studied and it was confirmed that it had been 1/3 of the normal yield, which made the peasants eligible for a total remission of revenue. Gandhiji advised the peasants to withhold the revenue. Vallabhai Patel and Indulal Yajnik helped Gandhi in the Kheda district by organizing his tour of the villages and urging the peasants to stay firm. The government unleashed severe repression, seizing cattle, household goods, and even attacking standing crops. After putting up a brave struggle, however, they began to suffer in the face of repression. At that very moment, Gandhiji learned that the government was contemplating a compromise by directing that the revenue be recovered from only those who could pay it. Gandhi had asked the well-off peasants also to withhold payment so that the poor peasants may not surrender. On learning of the government directions, Gandhiji withdrew the movement. Now, the outcome of the Champaran, Ahmedabad and Kheda movements that occurred between 1916 and 1917 was that Gandhi was able to experiment with his method of non-violent satyagraha. The movements helped him to test the waters, so to say. He cultivated his own core of group workers who would assist him and follow his orders in the forthcoming movements. In these movements, Gandhiji showed his special talent for reconciling apparently opposed interests, example, mill owners and workers, keeping his friendship with one and at the same time gaining the trust of the other. The next significant movement under Gandhi's leadership was the Rowlatt Satyagraha. In February 1919, two bills that would severely curb the civil liberty of Indians were sought to be made into laws. The government wanted to pass these laws so that they may be able to control the rising tide of discontent among the population. The laws would provide for arbitrary detention and punishment without trial, etc. In fact, one of the bills was passed in the council and made into law in spite of protests from the elected Indian members. Now, this kind of restriction on the liberty of the individuals might have been acceptable during the war years, but the end of the war had given rise to the hopes of further constitutional reforms and a greater control of Indians over their own affairs, if not self-government. Having seen the futility of the protests from the council members and others, Gandhiji launched Satyagraha. A Satyagraha Sabha was formed that attracted many workers. It was decided that a nationwide hartal or strike would be observed to protest against the act, and fasting and prayers will be conducted. There would also be civil disobedience of certain laws. The Rowlatt Satyagraha was the first nationwide protest in India under the guidance of Gandhi. The people of India showed a great and swelling resentment against British rule, and the hartals became violent. 6th April 1919 was decided as the day of hartal. However, due to some confusion, it was observed on 30th March in Delhi and led to fighting in the streets. Punjab had faced very severe wartime oppression due to forcible recruitment and widespread disease and other hardships. Amritsar and Lahore were centers of this movement. Gandhi tried to go to Punjab and get the movement back on the track of non-violent satyagraha. However, Gandhi was prevented from entering the Punjab by the British government and was deported to Bombay. Bombay and Ahmedabad were also experiencing disturbances at that time, and Gandhi tried to control the movement there. Events in Punjab came to a head when two local leaders were attacked and arrested, and the local town hall and post office were attacked as a result. During the nationalist movement, a popular form of protest was to attack the symbols of British government. Example, telegraph wires were cut off, post offices attacked, and Europeans, including women, were also attacked. The army was called and meetings and assemblies were banned. On 13th of April 1919, on Baisakhi Day, a gathering took place at the Jallianwala Bagh in Amritsar. Now, this invited the wrath of General Dyer, who was made in charge of the city. The general, angered that the ban on public meetings was being flouted, attacked the unarmed and helpless gathering and had his men fire at the crowd for 10 minutes and only stop when his ammunition was spent. No prior warning was issued to the people before firing started, and there was no escape either through the narrow pathways or any other, because General Dyer's men stood with their guns as the Jallianwala Bagh was enclosed by walls on all sides. This incident left 379 dead, according to a conservative government estimate. This brutal incident was followed by even more brutal repression. Then started the non-cooperation movement. Martial law was imposed in Punjab after the Jallianwala Bagh massacre. Inhuman treatment was meted out to Indians. Example, men were made to crawl on their bellies in the by-lane where a European woman had been attacked. Although the Rowlatt Satyagraha had been withdrawn, the feeling of resentment towards British rule grew even more bitter. The Montague Kempsford reforms of 1919 frustrated the hopes of those who still had any faith in the colonial government's intention for bringing about reforms enabling Indians to participate in the government. At this juncture, a large group of enlightened Muslim leaders emerged, and they had a special reason for discontent with the British government. The Muslims were offended by the insensitive treatment of Turkey after the First World War. Muslims all over the world regarded the Caliph of Turkey as their spiritual leader, and they had been assured that the Caliph will be treated leniently after the defeat of Turkey and its allies in the war. However, in the post-war treaty with Turkey, the powers of the Caliph were severely curtailed. Matters came to a head when the Hunter Committee that was appointed by the government to look into the Jallianwala Bagh tragedy submitted its report. In this report, they upheld the action of General Dyer and all other kinds of repression. This report enraged all the Indian leaders, and the moment was now ripe for the next protest movement. It was at this time that Gandhi contemplated a non-violent, non-cooperation movement. The non-cooperation movement was an expression of the growing resentment of all classes of the Indian people against the oppressive British rule. Gandhi took up three specific points on which the movement was initiated. One, the Khilafat wrong that was done against Turkey, the Punjab wrong, that is the firing at the Jallianwala Bagh, and Swaraj. The call for non-cooperation first came from the All India Khilafat Conference at Delhi on 23rd November 1919 at the initiative of the Ali brothers, Muhammad Ali and Shaukat Ali. At the Allahabad meeting of the Khilafat Conference, a program of four-stage non-cooperation was announced. Boycott of titles, of the civil services, of the police and army, and finally, non-payment of taxes. After that, Gandhi began to urge the members of the Congress to give their support to the movement. In the historical special session in Calcutta, September 1920, the Congress adopted a program of giving up of titles, a boycott of schools, courts, and councils, and also boycott of foreign goods. That was Bahishkar. This boycott would be side by side with the establishment of national schools and courts to resolve matters without taking recourse to the judicial system of the government and the adoption of Khadi. In the Nagpur Congress of December 1920, veteran Congress leader of Bengal, Chittaranjan Das, lent his support to the movement. Although the movement was formally initiated on 1st August 1920, Congress leaders' support gave a new impetus to it, and from January 1921, it gained great strength. Within a month, a large number of students left government-aided schools and colleges and joined national institutions that had been started in different parts of the country. Several well-established lawyers like Chittaranjan Das, Motilal Nehru, Saifuddin Kichlu, Vallabhbhai Patel, C. Rajagopalanchari, Asaf Ali, etc. gave up their lucrative practices. This sacrifice inspired the people. Boycott of foreign goods, picketing of shops, selling foreign cloth were other forms of protest. Charkhas began to be distributed and hand-spun cloth became popular among the nationalists. Nationalist newspapers held advertisements inviting people to participate in bonfires of foreign goods. The value of cloth exports fell to a great extent. Along with cloth shops, picketing of liquor shops was also done for the first time. To the alarm of the British government, Muhammad Ali in July 1921 appealed to all Muslims in the British Indian Army and declared that they must consider it morally wrong to be a part of the British Army and that they should not continue in it. He was arrested at once. This call was taken up by the Congress and Gandhi. A manifesto was issued calling all men, that is, civilian and soldier, to sever all links with the British Indian Army. In the midst of this, the Prince of Wales visited India in November 1921 and was greeted by a hartal in Bombay, where he landed, and also in the rest of the country. Gandhiji addressed a huge meeting on the day of the Prince of Wales' arrival. This anti-British feeling was so strong that a riot situation occurred when the people dispersing from the meeting came across the others who had gone for the welcome procession of the prince. Gandhi went on a four-day fast to reduce tension. The non-cooperation movement was gaining strength progressively. In Midnapore district of Bengal, a movement was organized against union board taxes and a no-tax movement was also organized in Andhra Pradesh. The refusal to pay taxes under the Gandhian scheme was to be resorted to in the very last and most radical stage of the movement. In the Awadh region of UP, the Kisan movement was gaining ground through the Kisan Sabhas, which were becoming more organized and a great threat to the British rule. The standoff of the colonial government was also becoming more rigid. The fall in cloth exports, the show of resentment from the students, lawyers, government officials, workers, peasants, plantation workers, and attempts to influence the army finally led to the adoption of repressive measures against the movement. Public meetings and assemblies were banned, newspapers repressed, and midnight raids were conducted at Congress and Khilafat offices. The Congress, under Gandhi's guidance, was beginning to chalk out a program of civil disobedience at Bardoli. This movement was, however, cut short by a violent incident at Chauri Chaura, in Gorakhpur district of UP. A Khilafat and Congress procession, on being confronted by some policemen, turned violent and attacked the police. The policemen tried to take shelter in the police station. However, the enraged mob set fire to it and hacked to death those policemen who came out to escape the fire. 22 policemen were killed. This incident occurred on the 5th of February, and on the 12th, Gandhiji withdrew the non-cooperation movement. This withdrawal proved that at this stage, Gandhi did not want to lead a movement which he could not control, and it also proved that the nationalists would heed Gandhi's call. For though there were many who differed from him, no one thought of defying Gandhi's call for withdrawal. In another episode, I am going to discuss further about Gandhiji and the nationalist movement till we Indians achieved our independence. Thank you.